More. Opera Forever is brought to you by a donation from the Schickelgruber Foundation and the loyal support of viewers like you. For 15 years, opera had one voice. From New York to Italy, the world of opera was turned upside down by a young man from Glendale, California. Alexander Moore toured the globe, bringing legions of new fans to the art form with a rock and roll attitude and charismatic performances. Frederick Middleman himself said of Alexander Moore, he was the best. There were none better. This is the story of the great rise and sudden collapse of opera's brightest star.
Well, when one asks, how did Alexander S. Moore change opera, one must first ask, did Alexander S. Moore change opera? And the answer is unemphatic. Yes. His work with Puccini, especially, it was sublime. His Rodolfo, Madama Butterfly, it was like watching the birth of a butterfly on stage, out of a cocoon. First it's a little sticky, a little awkward, ultimately rewarding. Haunting.
Alexander Moore, beautiful man. Very strong influence as far as presence and presentation. Well, his performance in Otello or in Die Zauberflöte, for instance, was just absolutely fantastic.
Of course, the big people loved him, you know. But for me, I really liked it. He wasn't a classically Italian trained, you know. He was from Glendale. He allowed the common man to really embrace opera. He exposed it to the masses, you know, dare I say the middle class. But really, I mean, that's what he did. From Glendale, enough said.
If he was still alive, he'd probably be selling those foam number one fingers at the Met by now.
The man had such a joie de vivre about him, you know? Make you tingle. Something the world has never seen before. That is, to me, opera. It's all about the soul and how you tingle.
Alexander S. Moore and Frederick Milhouse Middleman met in their late teens in Los Angeles, California.
I remember I met him at a local deli in Glendale. He just had a sparkle about him, and he just wanted to talk to me about opera. And I was... We can talk about opera. I mean, I enjoy opera. You enjoy opera. Let's talk about opera. You know, here was this 19-year-old business administration major at a community college in the local area just wanting to do opera. And I just thought to myself, why not?
I always view the resistance to him as more of a class kind of thing. Because, you know, here you have this guy, you know, he just kind of showed up on the scene, you know, doing some smaller gigs. And he didn't really have a lot of important mentor backing, you know. Honestly, I think they saw kind of like a middle, lower class kind of piece of trash. I think it was the bad boy of opera. Essentially, that's how he was perceived.
Despite glowing reviews, Moore and Middleman spent the early and mid-90s touring Europe and Asia, and performing to smaller-than-expected crowds.
We did a little bit of a tour in Europe. It was low budget, and we ended up in Frankfurt, Germany. And I gotta say, East-West relations were still a little tight in Germany at the time. We played a 800-seat venue. It was for the Red Hat Society. I don't know if you've heard about them. It's
who were the Red Hats?
Oh, well, 80-year-old and older German women. Yes, apparently no other standard than that, 80-year-old German women. Well, it was a controversial piece, but we thought a crowd pleaser nonetheless. Bit of Wagner. Sure enough, they had these women remembering a better time. A better time when Nazi wasn't a word you associated with evil.
Nathan Silver is maybe the worst agent I've ever run into. Every time I ran into him, I was thinking to myself, this man is single-handedly holding the greatest talent of this century when it comes to opera, when it comes to that emotional flexibility that Alexander was famous for. And I felt like he was abusing it.
Moore was married in 1997 and took the following year off, spending time with Middleman and his new wife, Catherine. During this year, they recorded 17 albums and 2 opera films.
For me, he was always an outsider. I believe they always saw him as an outsider. Now, I believe later on they learned to accept it.
Oh, the number one. All the way. That's what you said.
You see, back in those days, usually at least there were 5 good guys up there at the time, and usually I was number 2 and Alex was number 1.
You can't even have a number 2. Well, he's not even in that class. There's like his own standing.
With the second man, I found it more easily to free myself in the character. I got to experiment more. Alex was locked into the lead position. Second is great. So first is, what are you gonna do?
The year 2000 was spent in an ongoing engagement at the Teatro La Fenice in Venice, Italy.
His work there was groundbreaking. It really opened a lot of doors. I also feel like it marked the beginning of the end. He was working so hard. Every opera lead always talks about the strain of the vocal folds. I mean, they're only human. They're not machines. You know, the spirit can be willing, but the flesh can be bruised, broken.
Best years of my life.
It was 9 months.
That was 9 months out of the best year of my life.
During the time in Venice, Moore reached new heights of stardom with the release of his global hit, Caruso.
People forget that Alexander's Caruso not only was an artistic achievement, it was a huge hit on top. It's like what people say about Shakespeare. People say that Shakespeare is great despite the fact that people say that he is great. Caruso is great despite the fact that people say it is great. Alexander's Caruso comes on like a sunrise, a red sunrise. Foreboding. Its simplicity betrays itself. Its complexity is underlined. The emotional rawness. It's as though this beautiful man is standing in front of you, naked, glistening, throbbing.
While Moore was being universally lauded, Frederick Middleman's reviews were less kind.
Frederick Middleman. He's a little overweight, a little shy, maybe a little queer, but you know, lovable, but at the same time, completely repulsive because he needs to be loved. He is a leech of the First Order. And I think it held back Alexander for many, many years because he was always worried what his bedfellow was going to be doing in his projects.
Well, people can say what they want. But me and Alex's relationship, I mean, we were best friends. We've been through the thick of it, through the worst of it and the best of it. And it's just a shame that I'm saying we're best friends because you still should be around.